Hello there, welcome back to Beyond Ballistics. As promised, here's part 2 of my steel bluing guide, this one focusing on caustic bluing. If you haven't watched part 1 yet, covering rust bluing, you can find it at this link.
As the name suggests, caustic bluing involves using a caustic hot bath to give steel a black oxide coating. The basic composition calls for a concentrated solution of sodium hydroxide in water. To this base solution, an oxidizer is added.
This solution is then heated to its boiling point, and submerging a steel object in it will cause it to turn black.
Other colours can form, but that mostly depends on the particular steel composition, and you really have no control over that, so you can't really expect to obtain any colour other than black.
The main advantage of the process is that it allows getting a finished bluing in a matter of minutes, with very little effort, even on parts with complicated shapes.
Also, it doesn't etch the metal surface appreciably, and this means you can get shiny bluings. Unfortunately, the list of cons is quite long. First of all, it's a dangerous process.
You have to stand near a big pot of boiling hot, highly concentrated sodium hydroxide solution.
That is a hazard when cold, let alone at 130 degrees. Then, it requires the part to be fully submerged.
Otherwise, at the liquid-air interface, the part will take a different color than the rest. This means you'll need a tank at least as big as the part is, which means increased risks due to handling lots of dangerous fluid, increased costs, and more heating power required.
Finally, that nasty solution will eat away a lot of different materials.
That includes, for example, aluminum, tin, zinc, and many alloys containing them, including soldering alloys. This means you need to be absolutely sure of what your part is made out of before submerging it, or it'll be ruined permanently. Aluminum parts get devoured in a matter of seconds, and solder joints can be dissolved as well. This gave rise to the old rule of thumb saying that only steel can be allowed to touch the bluing solution.
Only unsoldered, steel-only items can be blued this way, and the same applies for the tank.
The best thing is getting a tank made out of plain mild steel. Keep in mind, even glass can't stand the hot hydroxide solution.
Now, let's get more into it. Although different recipes exist, they're all based on sodium hydroxide, which is the main component. Oxidizers and additives can vary from one recipe to the other, and as usual, I'm sharing the ones I normally use.
So for this you will need a lot of sodium hydroxide, which is going to be your main expense, distilled water, a bit of potassium nitrate, and a bit of slaked lime. And of course, personal protective equipment. First of all, I'm dissolving 40 grams of sodium hydroxide and 3 of potassium nitrate for every 60 milliliters of room temperature distilled water. You also have to add a bit of slaked lime to the solution. I'll explain later why that's important. The temperature of the solution will naturally rise as the lye dissolves, and I need to stir it thoroughly until everything is completely dissolved before turning the heating on.
This is extremely important, otherwise during heating a solid crust will form at the bottom of the pot, causing it to overheat, leading to a sudden steam flashing and a geyser of flesh-eating solution. Not good.
You also want to prepare 2 pre-treatment tanks, the first one containing a weak hydrochloric acid solution, about 5%, the second containing regular tap water. So only once you're sure that there is no solid left at the bottom, you can turn the heating on. You'll have to reach boiling, which for this solution happens at about 125 degrees C.
At that point, reduce the heating power to keep the bath to a very gentle boil. This will help reduce evaporation losses. Do not dip the parts in the tank before it has reached the 125 degrees mark, or the process might get stuck. More on troubleshooting later.
Then, dunk previously cleaned parts in the dilute hydrochloric acid for a couple of minutes. Take them out, rinse in the tap water tank, and then dip into the bluing solution. Make sure the part is completely submerged and avoid large flat surfaces laying flat on the bottom of the pot. You should soon start seeing the part darken, and the whole process will take anywhere between 10 and 30 minutes. As time passes and water evaporates, the solution will concentrate and the boiling temperature increase.
At higher concentration and therefore temperature, the process is quicker and you can get a part blued in as little as 5 minutes, which is the reason why some recipes call for a more concentrated solution straight from the beginning. However, there are good reasons why I'm not following those. They're more ideal for an industrial environment, where time is money, but they require some way of continuously compensating the water loss to evaporation. If that's not the case, the solution will quickly become too concentrated, and if the boiling temperature goes above 180 degrees C, side reactions will take over and instead of bluing, you'll be etching your parts.
Also, you can't simply add more water to the bath to dilute it, or you'll give that awful fluid another good occasion to injure you. It would be like adding water to boiling oil.
Plus chemical burns. You'd have to turn off the heat, wait for it to cool down to below 120 degrees C and then add distilled water. Starting with a less concentrated solution gives you a much wider usable temperature range while also being cheaper and safer to run.
Upon contact with the air, the bath will be quickly poisoned or carbonated by atmospheric carbon dioxide. Slaked lime counteracts this, being able to continuously regenerate the bath. A pinch of slaked lime should be stirred into the solution when it's first mixed, and before any subsequent use of the solution if you're planning to store it.
Talking about that, if you're storing the solution, try to seal it as best as you can between uses to limit contact with the air as much as possible. Don't ever try to handle the hot solution. If you want to store it in a jug, wait for the liquid to cool down and only use jugs made out of polypropylene. Most other plastics are dissolved by the solution.
Every time you reuse it, remember to add a pinch of slaked lime and one of potassium nitrate, since the oxidizer can get depleted as well.
One thing you should avoid is dipping parts that are still heavily rusted, since that rust will partially dissolve in the bath and cause problems later on. Also, you don't get a nice bluing if the part is still rusty when you dip it. Compared to rust bluing, this process is a bit fiddlier, so I want to give you some troubleshooting advice.
If at some point you see your parts not taking colour or not going all the way to black, it's either because you dipped the part in the bath before it got up to temperature or the bath needs regeneration. If it's the temperature, just take your parts out, rinse them, put them in the acid bath for a couple of minutes and start again once the temperature is over 125 degrees C.
If instead it wasn't the temperature, then it's either carbonate contamination or the oxidizer is depleted.
In this case, I caused it on purpose by not adding slaked lime when I first prepared the mix. What you should do is, again, take the parts out, rinse them and place them back into the pickling bath. Then stir into the mixture some extra slaked lime and potassium nitrate and redip the parts. This is the result after I've rinsed, dried and oiled those bayonets. If after following all these directions you're still having trouble on some specific parts, it's probably because of the type of steel. Some will just reach an orange to purplish colour and won't go any darker. There are a lot of examples of factory guns where some components look like that, I suspect for that same reason.
If you want black at all costs, you can take over with a few rust bluing passes. The bath can also be made more reactive by raising the temperature a bit, using additives such as small amounts of sodium nitrite or ferric nitrate, or using a different oxidizer, but that's not something I'd suggest to a beginner, and it's rarely a necessity anyway.
Once again, a huge thanks goes to my patrons, which as usual are all listed here. Thank you all for watching, subscribe if you'd like to see more, and I'll see you next time. Bye.